Good morning, everyone.
It's great to be a part of the ITS Asia Pacific Forum, and I'm really looking forward to the discussion this morning on connected and automated vehicles. My name is Marcus Burke. I'm the Executive Leader for Future Technologies at the National Transport Commission, and I'm pleased to share with you today the work that we've been doing on the regulatory framework for automated vehicles in Australia. The National Transport Commission is a government policy reform agency in Australia. Our role is to work with our state and territory government counterparts, along with the Commonwealth Government, to lead national reforms in our land transport system, working across road, rail and intermodal transport, all with the object of improving the safety, productivity and environmental outcomes in our land transport system. We have been working on the regulatory issues around automated vehicles for the last 4 years or so, and it's a good opportunity to update you all on where we are in this important reform. At the National Transport Commission, we are working on a goal which has been agreed by all of our transport ministers from around Australia of developing end-to-end regulation to support the safe commercial deployment of automated vehicles at all levels of automation. We think this is a very important goal in order to set the direction of our work, that we are aiming to move beyond trials to commercial deployment and have the framework in place when the technology is ready to be deployed. We are looking to develop a framework that can go throughout the life cycle of the vehicle and address a range of different applications and business models. And the reason that we are doing this is to ensure that we can gain the benefits for all Australians, the safety, mobility, productivity and environmental benefits that we can gain from this technology. Whilst the benefits, including the safety benefits, are yet to be fully quantified for automated vehicles, we have seen significant improvements in other industries making use of automation, including particularly in Australia, the mining industry, who have been one of the leaders in the world in the use of automation for their vehicles, both road and rail. We have mine sites in Australia using hundreds of automated vehicles, and some of them have reported as much as a 90% reduction in safety incidents as a result of introducing automation. Whilst this is a very different environment, a much more controlled environment, it does give an indication of the kind of benefits that we may see through automation. Australia has been recognised internationally as a leader in the development of regulations for automated vehicles. KPMG, in their 2019 and 2020 Automated Vehicle Readiness Reports, rated Australia as leading the world in the development of regulations for this important technology. So what do we mean when we're talking about automated vehicles? Automated vehicles are vehicles that include an automated driving system, a system that can both monitor the environment and control the dynamic driving task. That is the steering, braking and acceleration of the vehicle with little or no human input. These automated driving systems may be included in existing vehicle models. They could form part of entirely new vehicles, which look very different to what we see out on the road today. And they could also be installed or retrofitted into existing vehicles in our fleet. And we need to develop a regulatory framework that caters for all of these possibilities and the kinds of applications and business models that may support them. However, there's still a lot that we don't know about automated vehicles and their commercial deployment. There's still a number of uncertainties, including exactly when the technology will be ready for commercial deployment. We are seeing trials around the world, including trials in America, of vehicles without a safety driver behind the wheel. But we're yet to see those turn into a commercial reality. We still don't know exactly what applications will be most successful, whether that's freight or moving people, for example. We don't know the kinds of business models that might emerge to support these applications and how that might change the way companies operate today. We don't know what the consumer take-up will be and how much people will actually want to use this technology. As a result, it's very difficult to judge at the moment what the consumer use will be and the impact on road user behaviour. As a result, it's difficult to judge what the overall impacts on things like road safety along with congestion might be over time. This makes it a significant challenge for developing policy and regulation with all of these unknowns, but it does lead us to focus on what are the outcomes that we're trying to work towards and move away from prescriptive requirements at this point with all of these uncertainties. One of the other challenges for governments is to rethink the current paradigms around regulation for road transport. Currently, we regulate very separately for vehicles and for drivers, for obvious reasons. However, that is challenged when we have a vehicle that can actually do the driving. Today, we have regulation for vehicles both at first supply or first market entry, So the standards that we have in place for new vehicles, which are focused on the manufacturer of the vehicle. We then have standards in service when the vehicle is out on the road, which largely focus on the owner or operator of the vehicle to ensure that it's maintained appropriately and that it can continue to operate safely throughout its life on the road. On the right-hand side there, we also have regulation in place for drivers when they first enter the system through our driver licensing regime to ensure that they can safely operate a vehicle. We then have things like road rules and road safety legislation to ensure that they are continuing to use a vehicle safely out on the road. This split is challenged when we have a vehicle that can also do the driving. We have proposed, and our transport ministers have agreed, that also means we need to identify a new party in the system, the party that is responsible for the automated driving system. We have called this the automated driving system entity, as the company who has developed the technology and is bringing it to market and assuring governments and the public of its safety. We need to ensure that this party has appropriate responsibilities. It may be separate from the manufacturer of the vehicle. It may be a new technology company that's coming through. But we need to ensure that we have identified who is responsible and that their responsibilities are clear to give the public confidence, as well as giving confidence to industry. The NTC's automated vehicle program is focused on six key questions that we need to answer to get to the point of having end-to-end regulation in place to support the safe commercial deployment of automated vehicles. The six questions are up on screen, and briefly, this starts with trials. How do we support trials of automated vehicles in Australia? Secondly, defining who is actually in control of an automated vehicle is a critical part of the regime. We need to ensure that automated vehicles are safe when they first enter the market and that there are clear expectations around the standards that they need to meet. But we also need to ensure that they're not just safe on day one, but that they continue to operate safely 5-10 years down the track throughout their lifetime on the road. So that means that we need to ensure that the in-service safety of these vehicles is being regulated appropriately and being managed appropriately. We need to look at injury insurance and how we manage current arrangements for injury insurance in automated vehicle crashes, because there will still be crashes that happen even with these systems out on the road. And finally, we need to look at issues around data. These vehicles will gather a lot of data, which can be used in order to assure safety, as well as for other purposes, including insurance. And we need to ensure that the access to that data is appropriate to manage the risks, as well as to recognise the intellectual property of the systems in place. The first question that we need to look at is how we support automated vehicle trials in Australia. There have already been trials in every Australian state and territory, along with trials in New Zealand, and you can find the details of all of those trials on the AusTrade's website at the link that you can see up on your screen. The NTC and AusTrade's have developed guidelines for trials of automated vehicles to ensure that there's a consistent approach around the country in decisions to provide exemptions and permits for those trials to take place. Those guidelines set the requirements and expectations for industry looking to trial in Australia, including things like the scope of the trial, safety management plans, having appropriate insurance, and the data that needs to be captured. We have recently reviewed and revised those guidelines, and we have had a new version that was agreed by ministers in November 2020, and that we have recently published on our website. Trials are a very important part of learning for governments and for industry, and are an important part to feed into the work that we're doing on regulation and policy. The second question that we have examined is who is in control of an automated vehicle? Most people would probably be familiar with the levels of automation as set by the SAE standard. Existing vehicles, so level 0, 1 and 2 vehicles, will continue to be controlled by a human driver. The change will be when we look at levels 3, 4 and 5, that what we have proposed and ministers have agreed is that it's the automated driving system entity, the company that is bringing the technology to market, which will be considered to be in control and have the responsibilities of the driver when the vehicle is operating in automated mode at those higher levels of automation. A key point around level 3, conditional automation, where we will have a fallback ready user, is that the automated driving system entity will be considered in control, But if required, they can then call on the fallback ready user and pass back control to the human user, in which case it falls back and becomes a human-driven vehicle as per a level 0, 1, or 2 vehicle. The third question that we need to look at is how we ensure the safety of these vehicles when they first enter the market, the safety at first supply. The NTC has done some work on the safety requirements, which are now being implemented by the Commonwealth Department of Infrastructure. We have based that work on similar policy, which has been developed in the US, but catered to the Australian environment and the Australian regulatory system. Companies will need to self-certify against a set of 11 safety criteria, including things like the ensuring that there's an appropriate human-machine interface, that there's appropriate cybersecurity protections, and that it has been designed for the Australian road environment and for Australian laws. This puts the responsibility back onto industry, providing them with a lot of flexibility about the kinds of systems and vehicles that they might develop, as long as they can assure governments of the safety of their operations. However, we need to ensure that automated vehicles aren't just safe on day one. They need to operate safely throughout their life on the road, which may be 1 year, it may be 5 years or 10 years. So a key question is how to ensure that that safety is maintained. The NTC has done a lot of work on this issue over the last 18 months or 2 years to look at how we maintain that safety, who has responsibility, and how do we ensure that we have a nationally consistent approach to this issue. One of the challenges of this technology is that the vehicle is moving from a product to becoming more of a service that will need to be maintained over time. So the automated driving system will need to be maintained to ensure it's keeping up to date with changes to the road environment, changes to cybersecurity threats, or changes to road rules. We need to make sure that it continues to operate just as safely throughout its life as it does on day one. In 2020, our transport ministers agreed to key elements of the in-service safety approach, including that we will have a national regulator for automated vehicle safety and a national law, and that this will be underpinned by a general safety duty on the automated driving system entities, so the companies bringing the technology to market. Again, this idea of a general safety duty is to ensure that we're focused on the outcome of safety without being prescriptive about the means. So it gives a lot of flexibility to industry as to how they achieve that outcome, what mix of technologies they use, how they might evolve their business models. However, even with the best safety systems in the world, there will still be crashes, whether those are caused by human drivers, or by faults with the automated driving system, or by problems in the environment. We need to have an approach for injury insurance. We already in Australia have systems across the country of compulsory third-party insurance to cover injuries caused in road crashes. We have had agreement from transport ministers to the principle that no person should be worse off if they are injured in a vehicle driven by an automated driving system than if they're injured in a vehicle driven by a human driver. So there should be an equality of outcome regardless of who is in control of the vehicle. That means that existing schemes will cover crashes involving automated driving systems. That work does still need to progress further through treasuries and be agreed in legislation, but we feel that's an important principle to give assurance to the public about how they will be treated and to give them confidence that they will be covered in the event of a crash. Finally, we need to look at issues around vehicle-generated data. And this goes beyond automated vehicles to look across the vehicle fleet at vehicles that are increasingly becoming connected today and gathering a range of data from their sensors. There are a range of purposes that governments could potentially use this data for, to improve road safety, to improve network efficiency, network investment decisions, and also to make better decisions around the maintenance of their infrastructure. We have examined over the last 12 months the opportunities for vehicle-generated data, and coming out of that work, we are looking to set up a government and industry working group to further explore the opportunities that arise through vehicle-generated data, recognising the challenges around privacy, recognising the commercial interests of companies working in this space. There's a great deal of room for collaboration in order to give benefits to everyone. So across these six areas, we have tried to apply a consistent set of principles with safety as the key priority, but also looking to provide legal certainty both to the public and to industry. We want to ensure that responsibilities sit with those parties who are best able to manage the risks. And we want to ensure that we're taking an outcomes-based approach, not being prescriptive, to allow that flexibility to industry and allow systems to develop over time. We want to make sure that our work is internationally aligned so that Australia is part of the global vehicle market. And we want to ensure that the regulatory policy that we develop is neutral as to the applications, as to the business models and the technologies that might be used in this area. And we feel that all of this provides the ability for these systems to evolve over time and providing a regulatory system that can allow that evolution of the technology. We believe that working through these six key questions will help us to develop the end-to-end framework for automated vehicles in Australia and to achieve our goal of having that regulatory framework in place to support the safe commercial deployment of automated vehicles at all levels of automation, so that Australians can gain the benefits of this technology and that Australia can gain the investment in this important technology. We look forward to continuing to work with our key stakeholders, both governments and in industry, who really help to inform our reforms and make sure that they're fit for purpose. And I'd really encourage everyone to continue to contribute to the NTC's consultation processes to make sure that we're reflecting a really wide range of views in this very challenging area of regulation. Thank you again to the organisers for today, and I really look forward to the discussion, both in this session and across the week. Thank you.